Atrioventricular dissociation is defined as an independent activation of the atria and ventricles. Atrial activation is triggered by one pacemaker, usually the sinus node and rarely the atrial focus, while the ventricular activation is initiated by another, either the AV junction or ventricular focus. But firstly, let's remain how normally conduction system works. Regular heartbeats occurs when the sinus node conduct an electrical signal down to the atrioventricular node. Further, this electrical signal goes down to the Bundelovies and Purkinje fibers in the ventricles. The result is the contraction of the ventricles and pumping of blood from the heart to the arteries. Normally, rhythmic contraction of entire heart is initiated and maintained by the single pacemaker, the sinus node. Therefore, it is primary pacemaker. In addition, there are other special regions throughout the heart where the myocardial cells have normal, intrinsic ability to initiate impulses by automaticity. They include multiple sites in the right and left atria, the atrioventricular junction, and specialized conduction system of the ventricles. The cells are called latent or subsidiary pacemakers. Sinus node dominates all other potential pacemakers by its relatively faster rate and overdrive suppression. Let's schematically draw how the normal impulse goes through the heart. Impulse goes out from the sinus node and passes through the atria. We see it as a P wave on ECG. The conduction speed is 1 meter per second. That occurs almost instantly, so we draw the vertical line. In AV node, conduction speed is in 100 times lower than in atria. As a result, impulse need more time for passing through the AV node, so the line is inclined. On ECG is represented by PQ segment. When the impulse enters to the ventricles, the conduction speed again becomes higher up to 1 meter per second. So we again draw the vertical line, just like the atria. The ECG strip shows the QRS complex in this time. This normal direction of impulse, which is going from the sinus node down through the atria, AV node and ventricle, called anterograde conduction. When the heart stimulus goes in opposite direction from the ventricles, AV node to the atria, it is called retrograde conduction. In this case, in ECG, we see retrograde negative P wave after QRS. By the way, QRS can be changed in case of ventricular origin, or the same as usual in case of AV nodal origin. Also, atria and ventricles have a refractory period when it can't be stimulated. Refractory period may establish a basis for atrioventricular dissociation. The atrioventricular dissociation can be complete and incomplete. Let's start from incomplete. Firstly, let's draw the normal sinus complex and its conduction scheme with refractory periods. The incomplete AV dissociation starts from the situation when the impulse from the latent pacemaker arises near to the sinus P wave. So we have a sinus P wave, and due to some reason, AV nodal impulse arises near to this P wave. It means that impulse from the AV node falls in atrial refractory period. Therefore, this impulse from the subsidiary pacemaker can't be propagated up to the atria. At the same time, the sinus impulse can't be propagated down from the atria to the ventricles because of its refractory period after the polarization by latent pacemaker. This is AV dissociation onset. The inability to propagate impulses due to refractory periods without any structural changes called physiologic conduction block. The incomplete AV dissociation is characterized by faster ventricular rate than atrial. It means that RR intervals are shorter than PP intervals. Now look how it works. The next AV nodal impulse arises even closer to the sinus P wave than previous. Contraction by contraction, QRS complex becomes closer to P wave. In some period of time, P wave is totally merged with QRS. Or even positive P wave can be found in ST segment or T wave after QRS complex. But in some moment, AV nodal impulse arises so early to the sinus P wave that finds the atria tissue out of refractory period. And in this case, impulse from the AV node can be retrogradely conducted to the atria that will be represented by negative P wave after QRS. Now let's check the atrial and ventricular rates. Atrial rate is 85 beats per minute. The ventricular rate is near to the 100 beats per minute. So, ventricular rate is faster than atrial. Due to this, sinus P wave shifts to the right according to the QRS from beat to beat. In some moment, when AV nodal impulse arises so early compared to the sinus P wave, that finds the atria tissue out of refractory period, and in this case, impulse from the AV node can be retrogradely conducted to the atria that will be represented by negative P wave after QRS and called atria capture. But in case when retrograde conduction block occurs, early impulse from the AV node can't pass to the atria. But the next sinus impulse reaches the ventricles at the time when they are not refractory. Thus, impulse from the atria can be conducted to the ventricles, that called ventricular capture. Both atrial and ventricular capture interrupts the incomplete AV dissociation and confirms the physiological nature of conduction block. Ventricular capture is always premature compared to the previous latent ventricular rate. That makes RR interval irregular that can be easily detected on ECG. Thus, in ECG with incomplete AV dissociation will be periods of irregularity in the RR intervals when the latent pacemaker rhythm is interrupted and reset by ventricular capture beats. The capture beat characterizes only incomplete AV dissociation. The old name of this condition is AV dissociation with interference. Let's go to real example. In the onset, we see progressive shortening of PR interval and gradual shift of P wave to the right from beat to beat. In the middle part, we see that P becomes closer to QRS, fuses with it, and arises after QRS in the end of middle part and in the beginning of termination. So the second criteria of incomplete AV dissociation is present. Shift of positive P wave to the right from beat to beat. Now let's check the PP and RR intervals. The PP intervals is equal approximately 720 milliseconds. The atria rate is 83-85 beats per minute. Thus, the RR interval is approximately 680 milliseconds. The ventricular rate is 88 beats per minute. That means that ventricular rate is faster than atrial. Therefore, the first criteria of incomplete AV dissociation is present. And now look at the beginning of termination part. Here we see the irregularity of RR intervals. As a result, impulse from the P wave that is inside the shorter RR interval captures the ventricle. So we confirm the last criteria of incomplete AV dissociation, capture beats. Now let's go to complete AV dissociation. If the atria and ventricles are beating totally independently of one another, there is a complete AV dissociation. In this case, the rates should be nearly the same, so both PP and RR intervals are approximately the same. In this case, two pacemaker sources that initiate impulses from atria and ventricle fall in each other refractory periods. First PQRST complex is normal conduction of sinus impulse. Complete AV dissociation also starts from the situation when impulse from the latent pacemaker arises nearer to the sinus P wave. And after this, we see two different rates with the same frequency. Let's check the PP and RR intervals. The PP interval is 800 milliseconds, it means atrial rate is 75 beats per minute. The ventricular rate is vary from the 74 to 78 beats per minute. But due to the equal or near to equal rates of both atrial and ventricular impulses, P wave moves around the QRS or flirts with QRS, but it can't move so far from QRS for overcome the refractory period of ventricles, and ventricles impulse also can't move so far from atria refractory period. As a result, capture beats in case of complete AV dissociation are impossible. Another cause of capture beats absence is structural block between the atria and ventricles. This means that no atria impulses are conducted to the ventricle, and no ventricle impulses are conducted to the atria. So, there are only three possible manifestations of AV dissociation. The first one is AV dissociation by default. This occurs due to the slowing of the dominant pacemaker, such as the sinus node, leading to the dominance of an independent ventricular pacemaker, demonstrated by junctional and escaped rhythms. In this case, atrial rate is slower than ventricular. The second one is AV dissociation by usurpation. That is caused by acceleration of latent pacemakers in the ventricles, whose rate exceeds the intrinsic atrial rate. So the atrial rate is also slower than ventricular rate in this case. And the last one is complete heart block, when conduction between the atria and ventricles is prevented due to pathological blockade, leading to an independent rhythms. This is the only one case of complete AV dissociation when atrial rate is higher than ventricular. Look at this example. Atrial rate is 120 beats per minute, while the ventricular rate is 46-50 beats per minute. So as a result, all cases of complete heart block is example of complete atrioventricular dissociation. But not all cases of atrioventricular dissociation are due to complete heart block. If you like the content, press like, subscribe to our YouTube and Telegram channel, and have a good day. Here we go.